Thank you. The next item of business is consideration of business motion 23647 in the name of Graham Day on behalf of the Parliamentary Bureau setting out a stage three timetable. Could I ask Graham Day to move this motion?
Indeed, and apologies, Presiding Officer, it's been a long day.
Thank you very much, Minister. That is moved. No member wishes to speak against the motion. The question is that motion 23647 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. Thank you. So the next item is stage three proceedings on the Forensic Medical Services Victims of Sexual Offences Scotland Bill. In dealing with amendments, members should have with them the marshalled list and the grouping of amendments. I just remind members that the division bell will sound and proceedings will be suspended for 5 minutes for the first division of the afternoon, and the period of voting for each division will be up to 1 minute. Members who wish to speak in the debate on any group of amendments should press their request to speak button as soon as possible after I call the group. So turning to the marshal list, I call Group 1, Self-Referral, Age and Support for Under-16s Undergoing Forensic Medical Examination, Reports on Exercise of Power to Change Age of Self-Referral and Pilot Scheme. Can I call Amendment 1 in the name of Margaret Mitchell, grouped with Amendment 7, Margaret Mitchell, to move Amendment 1 and speak to both amendments. Thank you.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Both Amendments 1 and 7 relate to the provision of support for children in the 13 to 15 age group. And at the outset, I want to thank the Cabinet Secretary and her officials for taking the time to meet with me yesterday to listen to why I've tabled these amendments and for the extremely worthwhile discussion which took place. By way of background, these amendments have been tabled, taking into account the very welcome Scottish Government amendment at Stage 2, which provided for the ability to include this age group in the Bill's provisions for self-referral for forensic medical examination at some point in the future. The two amendments in Group 1 are therefore different from the ones I lodged at Stage 2. And they have been tabled, having listened very carefully to the comments the Cabinet Secretary made then, when it became clear that the Scottish Government has in progress extensive work in the form of the development in partnership with the Chief Medical Officer Task Force of the Children and Young People's Clinical Pathway. The aim of the CYP clinical pathway is to ensure a consistent national approach to the provision of a child-centred, trauma-informed healthcare and forensic medical examination following a concern raised or disclosure of sexual abuse. In addition to this, other Barnahus work is being undertaken and a child protection consultation is already underway. I welcome and pay tribute to the Government for getting to this stage and for the extensive and very positive work. These amendments do not, therefore, cut across or hinder this ongoing work, but rather they provide a mechanism by which to keep these issues to the forefront and to future-proof this legislation, especially given it comes at the end of this parliamentary session. Therefore, Amendment 1 requires Scottish ministers to publish a statement annually as to whether or not they will be bringing forward regulations as per Section 3A to change the age of self-referral. In addition, ministers must also outline what support is currently being provided or will be provided to a person under 16 who has been referred for a forensic medical examination by a constable. The aim of this amendment is to ensure that ministers regularly consider the age of self-referral and that consideration is given not only to the lowering of the age, but to the support that will be provided to those under 16s undergoing a forensic medical examination as a result of any change. And here I thank the Cabinet Secretary for the confirmation that she is minded to support this amendment. Turning now to Amendment 7, which gives ministers the power to introduce a pilot scheme whereby those 13 to 15-year-olds can self-refer for a forensic medical examination, and details that certain arrangements are to be made for children and young people as part of a pilot scheme. It's important, Presiding Officer, to put this amendment in the very sobering context in which it has been tabled. We know that child sexual abuse has increased dramatically during lockdown, and there have, sadly, been greater opportunities for child sex abuse in the home. Reporting this abuse has always been difficult, but even more so during COVID, as opportunities for disclosure are fewer. The acknowledgement of the need to create a safe space is crucial for those children who have been sexually abused to have the confidence to disclose. Self-referral offers another mechanism by which a young person can disclose, but even more importantly, to access the health and mental health care they need. A lack of access to physical and mental health care can have a devastating impact on a survivor's life, often causing them to use alcohol and drugs to self-medicate. The amendment, therefore, includes certain arrangements to be included under a pilot. For example, assigning to a relevant child an appropriate adult who must meet with the relevant child as soon as reasonably practicable after the forensic medical examination is requested. Before the medical examination can begin, they have to ensure that the relevant child has been provided with information about any child protection procedures and health procedures that will be followed. They must continue to coordinate support to the relevant child throughout any process that follow as a result of reported incidents, including coordinating support to the relevant child in any steps taken to meet the relevant child's healthcare needs as a result of the reported incident. These provisions provide the safe space necessary to encourage disclosure. There is a level of detail in the amendment which may appear, and it is prescriptive, but which is included deliberately to form a checklist to assess how the various aspects around the clinical pathway, child protection and Barna House are operating in supporting children and young people who are the victims of childhood sexual abuse and other sexual offences. If ministers do arrange for a pilot, they are required to lay before the Parliament a statement describing the scheme and how they intend to evaluate its outcomes. Once the pilot has ended, ministers must lay a report before Parliament setting out their findings and if they intend to do anything regarding the age of self-referral. Alternatively, and this is crucial, alternatively, if ministers choose not to introduce the pilot, they must explain to Parliament why they have chosen to do this. Presiding Officer, as stated previously, I very much welcome the work that is ongoing in Scotland to ensure that those children who are victims of childhood sexual abuse receive the support they need through the clinical pathway and the ambition Scotland has for Barna House and other related works such as GRIFIC, ACES and the UN Convention of the Rights of the Child. However, without the necessary safe space being created for 13 to 15-year-olds to have the confidence to disclose, the problem of fear of reporting sexual abuse will continue. And as a consequence, they will not have access to the health and medical care these vulnerable young people need and deserve.
Thank you very much. Thank you very much, Ms. Mitchell. I call Donald Cameron to be followed by the Cabinet Secretary.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I have very little to add to what Margaret Mitchell has just said. On Amendment 1, as she has just stated, that places a duty on government to consider annually the question of the age of self-referral. And to all of us who have been either in committee or in debate discussing the issue of age, we're all cognizant of what a difficult issue it is. And in my view, this allows simply for government to actively consider on a regular basis this difficult issue. And I hope that government will support this amendment. Amendment 7, the only point I wish to add is to note that this simply gives ministers the power if they choose to introduce a pilot scheme. There is no obligation, it's not mandatory, despite the prescriptive terms of the scheme which Margaret Mitchell alluded to. But ultimately, it gives ministers a choice and is optional. And for those reasons, Presiding Officer, it seems eminently reasonable and offers a practical solution to government if they wish to allow a scheme such as this to be trialled. And I hope the Chamber supports both these amendments.
Thank you. And I call on the Cabinet Secretary, Jean Freeman.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. There has been considerable interest in the parliamentary process to date on the minimum age for accessing self-referral. The final bill will state that the minimum age is 16 in line with current practice, but a delegated power was added at stage two so that the minimum age can be varied in future by regulations if that becomes justified in light of future changes to guidance, practice or legislation. I'm very grateful too to Margaret Mitchell for meeting with me yesterday to discuss and explain her amendments. I listened carefully to what she has said then and what she said today. In stage two proceedings and in yesterday's meetings and again today in this chamber, I want to recognise and thank her for her long-standing interest in supporting child victims. In the context that too few child victims disclose abuse, I know that Ms. Mitchell and I share a desire to tackle that. Against that background, I am pleased to support Amendment 1. Having considered the matter carefully, however, I cannot support Amendment 7. I believe it would be disproportionate to have a pilot scheme that would essentially offer self-referral access to forensic medical examination for a child or young person under 16, which would be at odds with existing child protection guidance and the need for healthcare professionals to follow that in all cases of child sexual abuse. I also worry that operating a pilot scheme in just one part of the country could unintentionally confuse young people and the multi-agency professionals who are there to support them about what services are available to them, adding to the difficult situation already faced by that young person. In yesterday's meeting, my officials and I explained that the Children and Young People Clinical Pathway, published by the CMO's task force last month, together with the revised National Child Protection Guidance, which is currently out for public consultation, need time to bed in. I'm of the view that legislating to the level of detail proposed by Amendment 7 would not actually deliver on the ambition sought. We know that children and young people who've experienced sexual abuse can face many complex barriers to disclosure, and work is happening across government to try to address these. I urge any member or stakeholder with an interest in this field to be mindful of the difficult balance between a young person's autonomy and the need to protect them, and to respond to the revised Child Protection Guidance consultation. At stage two, we debated different amendments then lodged by Margaret Mitchell, and in opposing those amendments, I undertook to give thought to how we can further support the NHS to implement the new clinical pathway for children and young people, including through provision of ongoing care and support for children and families to aid recovery. I can now let the Chamber know that an additional £0.5 million to help improve the NHS response to child sexual abuse through the development of child and family support workers across Scotland and to support implementation of the Children and Young People's Clinical Pathway has been provided. The total funding of £0.5 million includes £0.1 million already allocated to the West of Scotland region to test the child and family support worker model. Learning from this will help to inform how services will develop across the rest of the country. And I also give the commitment to ensure that each of the matters prescribed in Amendment 7 are given due consideration by government and the task force in the course of the implementation of the bill, should Parliament pass this at decision time. Whilst I've confirmed my support for Amendment 1, I would invite Margaret Mitchell to withdraw Amendment 7 in light of our meeting yesterday and what I have announced and committed to today. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. I call on Margaret Mitchell to wind up and to press and withdraw Amendment 1 in the first instance.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Well, I welcome the additional funding that the Minister has announced. But can I make it quite clear? The government would be under no obligation whatsoever to introduce this pilot. They would most certainly be under an obligation to address all the issues within the pilot as a checklist to look at how much progress has been made with the pathway, to see if that crucial issue of underreporting is being adequately addressed, and if not, are there measures within the pilot that could be used to make sure that that is addressed, or it just makes sure they have to report to Parliament that these measures are either not necessary or inappropriate. And we clearly both share the same objective, that this legislation should protect and do the very best it can to protect these vulnerable children. But my concern is about ensuring these issues continue to be considered by the Scottish Government of whatever political persuasion in successive years, and the underreporting and the resulting gap in health and mental health provision for young people is kept in view. Amendment 7 contains measures which could be considered in order to put in place the safe space for the 13 to 15-year-olds to have confidence to disclose sexual abuse. It ensures that discussion will take place, and as such, there is much greater chance of these 13 to 15-year-olds accessing the health care they need and changing their lives around early. It is early intervention. That's why, if there's even the slightest chance, Presiding Officer, that this amendment could be passed this evening, I'm pressing it.
Thank you very much, Ms. Mitchell. We'll come to Amendment 7 in a second, but the first question is that Amendment 1 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. Thank you. Turning to Group 2, this is cases where only preliminary evidence gathering takes place. Can I call Amendment 2 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, grouped with Amendments 3, 4, 5, 12, 13, 14 and 15. Cabinet Secretary, to move Amendment 2 and speak to all the amendments in this group.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. This group concerns preliminary evidence gathering, sometimes referred to as early evidence taking. Early evidence can be crucial since urine, blood or hair clippings taken ahead of forensic medical examination properly might demonstrate that a victim was so, for example, intoxicated that they could not have consented to sexual activity. Victims have a fundamental right to determine what aspects of a full forensic medical examination proceeds, if any, so early evidence might be particularly important to any future criminal investigation. A number of sections in the bill refer to, and I quote, the need for an examination, to examinations being, quote, carried out, or to a person undergoing or who underwent an examination. Potentially, therefore, references to a forensic medical examination having been carried out would read as requiring a full physical examination having been carried. To support the early evidence practices mentioned, Amendment 15 adds additional interpretive provisions to the interpretation of Section 13, including subsection 4, which will act as an interpretive gloss to the references within Section 6, 7, 8 and 9 of the Bill, so that where an individual is referred for or requests forensic medical examination, but for whatever reason, the physical examination does not go ahead, the health boards can competently store evidence, and such evidence can be transferred to the police if and when the victim so wishes. Amendment 14 is consequential, and Amendments 2 to 5 make related amendments to Section 4 of the Bill. Lastly, Amendments 12 and 13 address a minor inconsistency in Section 12A, the new definition of evidence added at Stage 2, so that references in all its subsections refer to things collected or created during or in connection with the examination. I move Amendment 2.
Thank you very much. And no members have indicated they wish to contribute in this group, so we go straight to the question. The question is that Amendment 2 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. Can I call Amendments 3, 4 and 5 and invite the Minister to move these amendments en bloc?
Moved en bloc.
Thank you. Does any member object if I take all three questions en bloc? No. The question therefore is that Amendments 3 to 5 are agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. Thank you. Turn now to Group 3, Integration of Bill Functions with Functions under the National Health Service Scotland Act 1978. Can I call Amendment 6 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, grouped with Amendments 17 and 18. Cabinet Secretary, to move Amendment 6 and speak to all the amendments. Thank you.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Amendments 6 and 18 address the nuance that a health board's duty to provide certain services under the National Health Service Scotland Act 1978 legal framework has a residency-based element, whereas the provision of health services under the Bill should, at least for the immediate health care of forensic medical examination needs, be open to everyone seeking them. This is in line with the existing duties that health boards have to provide accident and emergency treatment to people regardless of their residence status. It is appropriate that long-term health care needs, such as access to ongoing psychological therapy or support, are addressed by the healthcare system of the place where the victim is ordinarily resident. Amendment 6 amends Section 5.1 of the Bill, and Amendment 18 amends Paragraph 2 of the Schedule to the Bill, which amends Article 2.1 and 3 of the Functions of Health Board Scotland Order 1991, so that the policy mentioned can be given effect to in the 1978 Act Legals Framework. As the wording of Amendment 18 specifically highlights, it is appropriate that a survivor who has accessed support under the Bill can return at the request or on the recommendation of the relevant health board for follow-up care. That might be, for example, to check up on any injuries. Presiding Officer, Amendment 17 makes final consequential amendments to the National Health Service Scotland Act 1978, sometimes known as the 1978 Act. I flagged to the Health and Sport Committee in the course of Stage 2 proceedings that technical amendments of this nature might be brought forward at Stage 3 so that existing NHS Scotland legislation dovetails with the Bill's provisions. Amendment 17 modifies Section 2.5, 2B, 10H and 17A of the 1978 Act in consequence of this Bill, building on modifications already contained in the Bill. And I move Amendment 6.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. And again, no member has indicated they wish to contribute in this group, so we move straight to the question. The question is, that Amendment 6 be agreed to? Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. Now, I'm going to call Amendment 7. This is the name of Margaret Mitchell, who has already debated an amendment with Amendment 1. Margaret Mitchell, to move or not move?
Moved, President.
That is moved. So the question is, that Amendment 7 be agreed to? Are we all agreed?
No.
We're not agreed. This is the first division of the afternoon, so I'm going to suspend Parliament for 5 minutes and to allow us to summon members to the chamber. So Parliament is suspended for 5 minutes. Thank you, colleagues. I'm just going to resume. We're going to resume proceedings now. And just remind members that we are in Group 3, and I've just called Amendment 7. So we're going to go straight to a vote on Amendment 7 in the name of Margaret Mitchell, and members may cast their votes now. This will be a one-minute division on Amendment 7. That vote is now closed. If any members believe they were not able to exercise their vote, please let me know. Thank you. The result of the vote on Amendment 7 in the name of Margaret Mitchell is yes 58, no 65. There were no abstentions. The amendment is therefore not agreed. We're going to move on now to Group 4. This is on minor amendments, and I call Amendment 8 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, group with Amendment 16. Cabinet Secretary to move Amendment 8.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. Amendment 8 ensures that the drafting of the bill accurately reflects the policy intention that dry, that is to say non-sample evidence, would never be stored by health boards without, as an absolute minimum, some forensic notes also being taken. The wording in Section 7.1 referring to evidence that comprises or includes an item is therefore too wide. Comprises means the entirety of something, so where there will always be other evidence, then the stored evidence will never comprise solely of items of dry evidence. Includes is therefore sufficient on its own, which is why Amendment 8 removes the word comprises or from Section 7.1. Amendment 16 amends Section 15.1 of the bill so that Section 12A, the new definition of evidence added at Stage 2, is included in the sections of the bill that come into force automatically on the day after Royal Assent. This reflects that the substance of Section 12A was previously contained in Section 13 of the bill, which has always been listed in Section 15.1 as a section that would commence automatically. It is standard that the interpretative provisions in bills commence automatically, and I move Amendment 8.
Thank you very much. And again, no member has indicated they wish to contribute, so we go straight to the question. The question is that Amendment 8 be agreed to. Are we agreed? Yes. We are agreed. I'm going to turn to Group 5 now. This is on the self-referral forensic medical examination of persons below self-referral age. Can I call Amendment 9 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary, group with Amendment 10. Cabinet Secretary to move Amendment 9 and speak to both amendments.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. We debated the minimum age for accessing self-referral in the first group of amendments. Amendments 6 and 18 in this group seek to address a scenario that could arise irrespective of the minimum age. I wish to firstly emphasise the government does not envisage that this situation should arise often or indeed at all, since there are no indications that it has arisen in existing self-referral services in Scotland or the rest of the UK. However, potentially self-referral might be offered in good faith to a young person thought to be of or over the minimum age, but it later transpires that they were under the minimum age at the point of examination. As members of the Health and Sport Committee will know, forensic medical examination is time critical and the DNA capture window is only 7 days. The requirements of trauma-informed care, now enshrined more prominently in the bill, also align with the Healthcare Improvement Scotland standard that examinations should take place within 3 hours of a referral for an examination being received. Very often, it will be swift and straightforward for a health board to determine the age of a young person seeking to self-refer from their NHS Scotland records. However, I cannot discount that there could be rare cases, for example, involving a trafficked young person, where it is not so straightforward. These are not entirely new scenarios in the forensic medical examination context or otherwise. The Bill recognises that experienced paediatric and other clinicians can be trusted to exercise appropriate professional judgment in difficult cases. However, the new clinical pathway for children and young people who may have experienced sexual abuse, which was published in November this year, will be updated ahead of the commencement of the Bill's self-referral provisions to provide further specific guidance on this point in the context of the new child protection guidance, which is currently out for consultation. The self-referral protocol being developed by the Chief Medical Officer's Task Force, which will be submitted to the Lord Advocate for his approval prior to publication, will also provide guidance for clinicians on what to do in these rare scenarios. Against this background, Amendments 9 and 10 clarify the Bill's position where a child is reasonably believed to be of or above the minimum age for accessing self-referral, then accesses self-referral, but it later transpires that their true age is under the minimum age. The main amendment is Amendment 10, which would create a new section providing that where there has been incorrect self-referral, things done by the health board remain legally valid, pending expeditious collection of any evidence by the police in line with established practice. This should ensure that any evidence taken by a health board in these circumstances is admissible in any criminal proceedings. In consequence, new subsection 3 disapplies sections 7 and 8 of the bill, including the duty on the health board to destroy evidence at the end of the retention period set under section 8, given that the police will seek the transfer of evidence from those who are under the minimum age for self-referral. Subsection 4 clarifies what is to happen if a victim is seeking to exercise rights under sections 7 and 8 at the time their true age is discovered. For example, a victim who is entitled to self-refer has the right to request that certain items of evidence provided by them be returned. They also have the right to request that such items be destroyed if they do not wish to make a police report. Unless it has done so before the true age has been discovered, a health board will not be required to act on those requests. Amendment 9 is consequential, adding a new paragraph C into section 9.1 of the bill, applying the evidence transfer gateway in section 9 to incorrectly held evidence. The health board's duty to report child sexual abuse is covered by existing child protection guidance and practice, and this will be emphasised in the self-referral protocol I mentioned. That then prompts the police to expeditiously collect any evidence of child sexual abuse. I move Amendment 9.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. And no member has indicated the wish to contribute in this section, so we move straight to the question. The question is that Amendment 9 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. Can I call Amendment 10? Cabinet Secretary to move.
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that Amendment 10 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Yes. We are agreed. We're going to turn now to Group 6. This is on victim support information and referrals. Can I call Amendment 11 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary? Group with amendments as shown in the groupings. Cabinet Secretary to move Amendment 11 and speak to all the amendments in this group.
Thank you. Presiding Officer, this is the grouping with the most amendments in it. They have a common core, improving the victim support information and referral provisions in the bill. The Victims and Witnesses Scotland Act 2014 aims to put victims and witnesses' interests at the heart of the modern justice system. It places duties on the police to provide victims' rights information and details of victim support services, which will already apply to police referral victims of offences because they have been in contact with the police. We want to ensure that people who choose to self-refer under the bill have the same rights to have information provided to them as people who decide to make a police report do. The relevant parts of the 2014 Act do not legally apply to victims of harmful behaviour by a child under the age of criminal responsibility. For continued consistency with the 2014 Act, the provisions in this group have the same legal application. The bill is introduced, made provision in the schedule for relevant aspects of the 2014 Act to be applied to all victims accessing forensic medical services under the bill. The amendments in this group replace those provisions and aim to improve and clarify the bill's approach to the 2014 Act. I'm pleased to confirm that the amendments in this group have been shared in draft and approved by Victim Support Scotland. The policy aim is to ensure that relevant 2014 Act rights are available to all victims of offences, irrespective of whether they follow a police referral or a self-referral route. The key amendments in the group are Amendments 11 and 27. Amendment 11 inserts a new section into the bill applicable to self-referring victims of offences. Rights to access the Victims Code for Scotland, victims' rights information and referral to victim support services are made available via the health board to which the victim has self-referred, equivalent to those in Sections 3C and 3D of the 2014 Act that apply to police referral victims. Amendments 19 to 26 are consequential on Amendment 11. They each amend paragraph 3 of the schedule, which amends relevant provisions of the Patients' Rights Scotland Act 2011, so that the patient rights principles apply to health boards when discharging their new obligations created by Amendment 11. Since victims accessing services under the bill are both patients and victims, it is appropriate that they receive all relevant rights under both the 2011 and the 2014 Acts. The principal function of Amendment 27 is to add a new Section 8A into the 2014 Act applicable to police referral victims, supplementing the provisions of Section 3C and 3D of that Act by ensuring that police inform victims they are referring that they can also request victim rights information and so on from the Health Board. Amendment 27 also removes subparagraphs 2 and 3 of paragraph 4 of the schedule of the bill, which are the former provisions that this grouping of amendments replaces. Amendment 29 is consequential on Amendment 27. It adds a final subparagraph 5 to paragraph 4 of the schedule of the bill, amending Section 29A1 of the 2014 Act to reference new Section 8A, ensuring that functions under that section are, where the victim is a child, exercised in the same way as other functions under the 2014 Act. And I move Amendment 11.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. Now, no member has indicated they wish to speak in this section either. So we move straight to the question. The question is that Amendment 11 be agreed to. Are we agreed?
Yes.
Now, could I invite the Cabinet Secretary to move Amendments 12 to 27, all of which have been debated, move them en bloc?
Moved en bloc.
Thank you. Does any member object if I take all amendments from 12 to 27 en bloc? No member does, okay. The question therefore is that amendments 12 to 27 are agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. So I'm going to turn now to group 7. And this is requests as to persons by whom forensic medical examination carried out. Can I call amendment 28 in the name of Joanne Lamont in a group on its own? Joanne Lamont to move and speak to amendment 28.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and may I move the amendment in my name. We all know this is an important piece of legislation for all victims of sexual violence, and we also recognise that it continues to be a crime perpetrated overwhelmingly by men on women. This legislation seeks to make practical steps, trauma-informed, to allow victims of sexual violence to take back control and have consent, following the horrific experiences where they had been denied both. For context, in relation to my consideration of this amendment, as someone with a long-term interest in this field, I sat through the Stage 1 debate, and I cannot overstate the impact it had on me. I was moved and hugely affected by the quality of the cross-party agreement, the powerful speeches, and the substantial nature of the recommendations. Members of the committee spoke about the courage of survivors who had given evidence at a meeting facilitated by Rape Crisis Scotland. And it was evident that those survivors had a huge impact on members, and I have no doubt that their testimony shaped the committee's thinking and its thoughtful recommendations. This amendment seeks to give force to the recommendation agreed unanimously by the committee. It says, we consider the definition of gender could be ambiguous in the bill, which has the potential to cause distress to individuals undergoing forensic medical examination. We recommend the bill be amended to guarantee an individual's right to choose the sex of the examiner. No one spoke out against the recommendation in the debate, and a number spoke explicitly in its favour. No group or organisation spoke against the Stage 1 report or any of its recommendations when it was published in September or when it was debated on the 1st of October. So this amendment simply reflects a recommendation in a Stage 1 report thoughtfully considered. At that point, it did not seem to be problematic, and there was no evidence that the people had concerns. So to be clear, if members do not agree that women survivors of violence and rape should be able to ask for a women's examiner, then say so, and we can have that debate. But be clear, as Rape Crisis Scotland said, that is what women survivors explicitly sought. So if you do agree, we should all do what we can to make that wish real. Those who are now expressing concerns about this amendment make a number of points, and I want to address those and will, of course, take the opportunity to address further ones as they are raised. Firstly, the point is made that there are not enough female examiners, so the amendment is meaningless. But that is to argue that the provision is meaningless, not the wording. If the provision is meaningless, the logical position would be to argue for its deletion instead of resisting a change in wording. And what a council of despair. Are we simply to give up because we currently do not have enough examiners? The survivors of abuse are not fools. Of course not. This legislation can and should drive change, translating through workforce planning and spending a real difference in provision. And is that not why we as legislators are here? Secondly, we are told there is no reason to change because the words sex and gender are interchangeable. But if they are interchangeable, why resist an amendment which uses a term defined in law? If it does not matter, why fear clarity? But of course, these terms are no longer interchangeable, as I have come to realise. And how do I know? Because in various statements, Fiona Hislop, a government minister, has said we would not conflate sex and gender. Shirley Ann Somerville, a government minister, has said we should not conflate sex and gender. Hamza Yousaf, a government minister, has said we should not conflate sex and gender. And in gender, Rape Crisis Scotland, Zero Tolerance, at various points in recent times, amongst other groups, have sought definitions of gender which are explicitly not interchangeable with the word sex, a word defined in the Equality Act of 2010. In giving people rights, in giving women victims of rape and sexual assault rights, in giving all survivors of sexual violence rights, we need to be precise. Sex is defined in law and gender is not. A right is not a right if it's unenforceable. We owe it to survivors to listen and treat them with respect. So in summary, survivors showed great courage in shaping this bill. The committee showed great integrity in responding to their evidence and unanimously agreed the recommendation to which this simple amendment responds. There is a direct, traceable and powerful course from the survivors' testimony to our decision on this amendment here and now. And I could put it no clearer than the statement of one member of the committee who said, "I feel a sense of great responsibility, not only to speak to ensure that the bill fully serves its purpose, but also to use this platform to give voice to those who have been silenced for so long." That is our challenge now. If we applaud survivors for their courage, if we are moved by their testimony, it is our responsibility and duty to respond. It is what we are for, and I trust members will agree and vote for my amendment.
Thank you. I call Sandra White to be followed by Donald Cameron. Sandra White.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and may I thank Joanne Lamont for putting forward this amendment. This bill is very, very important. Yes, it is emotional. It's really important for the survivors of sexual abuse. I go by the evidence that we were given by the women, very courageous, who gave us that evidence. I also go by the evidence we got at committees from organisations, and unanimously the committee, as Joanne Lamont has said, supported this at stage one. At stage two, I also raised the issue and was comforted by the words that the Cabinet Secretary gave to me and to the committee, that if a woman asked for a female examiner, they would receive that female examiner. I also, and the evidence that was given to us by the women, the survivors, this was one of their top priorities, to be able to ask for a female examiner, female doctor, female nurse. And we heard very emotional contributions from the women survivors. We were very uncomfortable. They were in trauma, and to be examined by a male doctor traumatised them even further. So I do thank Joanne Lamont for bringing this forward. I'm certainly in support of this amendment. It could be placed as perhaps technical, as the Victim and Witnesses Bill, but this debate and this bill is far too important to not support, in my belief, this amendment. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Ms White. And I call Donald Cameron to be followed by Monica Lennon.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The Scottish Conservatives will be supporting this amendment. As others have said, we believe that the views of the Health and Sport Committee are very important here. The committee unanimously recommended that the bill be amended to guarantee an individual's right to choose the sex of the forensic medical examiner in preference to the word gender. Of course, this does not necessarily mean that female victims will get to see a female forensic medical examiner, because there are issues of staffing, and that is something which the government needs to address going forward and do so urgently. There is plainly a wider ongoing debate and an important debate about rights of gender and rights of sex. But in my view, that is not what we are debating here. The issue here is very specific. And if ever there was a practical example of an instance when the word sex should be preferred over gender, then this is it. The time at which a victim of a sexual assault requires a forensic medical examination is likely to be a moment of deep trauma and needs handling with great sensitivity. And at that point, and in these very specific circumstances, we believe the choice requires to be one of sex and not gender. There is one other issue to reflect on, and it was mentioned by Joanne Lamont, and it's a legal one. The Equality Act 2010, 10 years old this year, and the place where all protections against unlawful discrimination are located, uses the word sex, and it has a legal definition. Now, again, there is an important debate to be had about that and whether that list of protected characteristics needs updating. But that too is not for now. And for these reasons, and for the very powerful and compelling arguments made by Joanne Lamont, we will be supporting this amendment.
Thank you very much. And I call Monica Lennon to be followed by Andy Whiteman. Monica Lennon.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I strongly welcome this bill and pay tribute to Rape Crisis Scotland and other women's campaigners who have campaigned for years to bring this about. In relation to Amendment 28, I firstly want to say that I fully support the principle that survivors of sexual violence should have the right not just to request a female medical examiner in the aftermath of a sexual assault, but for that right to be realised in practice. However, it would be misleading to give anyone the impression that the amendment and the passing of the bill by itself will ensure survivors get timely access to a female forensic examiner. It is a sad fact that the bill by itself will not lead to a material change in circumstances for many survivors. As we've heard, there are simply not enough female examiners in the profession currently to meet that demand. So beyond the bill, increasing the representation of women forensic examiners is where our collective focus must now be. Like many MSPs, I have received correspondence over the last few days asking me to support Amendment 28. Whilst much of the content of those emails is genuine and sincere, there are some that are unfortunately blatantly hostile towards trans women and the trans community. This is troubling, as is some of the narrative abuse and trolling that I have seen on social media. Clearly, there are some people who want to exclude trans women from working with women and girls who have disclosed rape or sexual assault. And there are some people who believe that Amendment 28, which replaces the word gender with sex, will help to achieve that, because they are of the view that this amendment will prevent trans women from carrying out such examinations. And this is not correct, because under the law, a trans woman with a gender recognition certificate is legally of female sex. Joanne Lamont is correct to say that clarity is important. And I believe it is important that any misinterpretation is cleared up. And I hope that all colleagues will take the opportunity to assist with that and condemn any unacceptable abuse that they see towards Rape Crisis Scotland and others. Because Rape Crisis Scotland, in their recent statements, have simply correctly stated that this amendment by itself makes no practical difference. And finally, Presiding Officer, I want to put on record again my thanks for the work of all of those staff and volunteers at Rape Crisis Scotland. The online abuse that I have seen targeted towards them in recent days is unacceptable. There must be zero tolerance for it, and we should all be calling it out. It is thanks to the work of Rape Crisis Scotland over many years that we have this bill, and that it will help many survivors of sexual violence. I commend the Scottish Government for introducing the bill, and I look forward to working with ministers on a strategy to address the underrepresentation of female forensic examiners and towards the eradication of gender-based violence towards all women and girls. I look forward to the bill passing tonight and for us all to collectively focus on supporting survivors through our words and our deeds. Thank you.
Thank you, Ms Lennon. I call Andy Whiteman to be followed by Emma Harper.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. This debate is about victims of very, very serious crime. Some of the most heinous crimes that can be committed against a person. And as Rape Crisis Scotland state, the feedback we have from survivors is that the most important issue is access to a female doctor. The lack of access to a female doctor is what causes the most trauma. I've thought long and hard about this, and I'm speaking in my own capacity. Victims of crime have told me directly how important it is that access is available to a female examiner, and I thank them sincerely for the experiences they have shared with me. That importance, Presiding Officer, is beyond any doubt. Now, I came to the view after looking at this proposal early this week in what has been an extremely busy week, that the statutory interpretation of Section 9 of the 2014 Bill was clear. It was clear because the intention of the Stage 2 amendment lodged by the Cabinet Secretary for Justice, Kenny McCaskill, at the time, was to do precisely what Scottish Women's Aid and Rape Crisis Scotland wanted at the time, namely that female victims, survivors, should be able to request a female doctor. It followed debate on what became Section 8 of that Act, the right not to actually just request, but to actually be interviewed by a female interviewer. And that provision was in order to implement an EU directive, 2012/29, of 25th October 2012, which established EU minimum standards on the right support and protection of victims of crime. And Article 23.2d of that directive states that measures shall be available which include that all interviews, and I quote, with victims of sexual violence, gender-based violence, or violence in close relationships, unless conducted by the prosecutor or a judge, being conducted by a person of the same sex as the victim, if the victim so wishes, provided that the course of the criminal proceedings will not be prejudiced. And what became Section 9 of the 2014 Act was agreed as an extension to the then Section 8 provisions. So I'm not convinced that it is necessary to make any amendments to the 2014 Act to secure its principal purpose of ensuring that victims have some say in the sex of their examiner and their interviewer. And the conflation of sex and gender in this context is not, in my view, particularly problematic as it's very clear from the intention behind the 2014 Act in Principle Section 8 and Section 9 that it was indeed to provide access to a female doctor where a female victim requested that, and to the extent that the courts will always interpret legislation in line with what the intentions of Parliament were, I think they're fairly clear from that and from the EU directive. However, I am concerned that the use of the term gender in the 2014 Act may in future be open to greater ambiguity as a result of contemporary debates about the rights of transgender people. Gender and sex are distinct terms with different meanings, but in 2013, that was not so regarded. Now, latterly, I was inclined to support Jahan Lamont's amendment, as I think it could or might put rest to any legitimate doubts that might exist. But I am concerned at the tone of some of this debate. I'm concerned that there has been no scrutiny of Amendment 28, and that for many people, this seems to be a debate about anything other than the victims of sexual assault. And so in conclusion, Presiding Officer, I am concerned about the possibility of ambiguity. I would invite the Cabinet Secretary to set out how she might explore how this ambiguity may be resolved in future, and whether such legislation already on the statute books does indeed need to be clearer about the distinction in order to put any doubts to rest. And with that, Presiding Officer, I will be voting against the amendment.
Thank you very much, Mr. Wyman. Can I call Emma Harper, followed by the Cabinet Secretary? Emma Harper.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. This is a very serious issue, and access to a female examiner is extremely important, and work is ongoing. The evidence we heard at committee was focused on promoting the best care for survivors of rape and sexual assault. We were focused on supporting all survivors of rape and sexual assault and making the process of forensic medical examination a process where persons, mostly women, are supported in the best holistic way. And currently, in the NHS Scotland Patients' Rights Charter, which is underpinned by the Patient Rights Scotland Act 2011, it states that persons already have the ability to express their preference of gender in their medical practitioner. And for the purposes of this Forensic Medical Services Bill, there has been a concerted effort by the NHS and the Scottish Government to increase the number of female practitioners, both forensic medical doctors as well as forensic nurses. There are now 118 medical doctors, and 70% are female, and 98% of the forensic medical nurses are female. And that training is ongoing so that there is enough women forensic examiners. So I would like to seek maybe some clarity that when this amendment is passed, and I'm sure it will be because words are very, very important now, and I know that there's been lots of discussion about how we differentiate between gender and sex. So when this amendment is passed, I just want to seek some clarity that the law already exists, that persons, women already have the right to express their preference over who attends, who examines, or who interviews them. So I would like to conclude. I'd say I will support this amendment, but I would like to conclude by thanking everyone who participated in the bill process, including all the witnesses who contributed.
Thank you very much, Ms. Harper. And can I call on the Cabinet Secretary, Jean Freeman?
Thank you very much. Presiding Officer, as I have clarified at earlier stages of this bill, neither the word gender nor indeed sex actually appear in this bill. The reality is that changing the wording from gender to sex in Section 9 of the Victim and Witnesses Bill Scotland Act 2014 changes nothing about how vital forensic medical services that this bill is actually about are delivered. My focus and my energies are directed to dramatically improving the provision of these services, and I will not be opposing this amendment. Should a woman be the victim of a sexual assault, she currently has the legal right to ask for a female examiner. That remains the case whether this amendment passes or not. All victims, irrespective of sex, gender identity, or other characteristic, will be entitled under the bill to the same care and support. And importantly, further to a Stage 2 amendment, the principle of trauma-informed care now has much greater prominence in the bill. The bill now specifically provides that health boards must seek to avoid re-traumatisation. Victims are no longer examined in police stations, and the number of female sexual offence examiners on rotas has dramatically increased over the recent period. We need to do much more than that, and we need to go much further. In the second quarter of 2020, over 75% of examinations were carried out by a female examiner and within the three-hour timeframe specified in national quality indicators. And in nearly 90% of cases, forensically trained female nurse was present throughout the examination. I know all members will welcome this progress, but this bill and the point of this bill that should not be lost is about improving this even more. Presiding Officer, it should be noted that the meaning of the term sex and gender are not defined by the 2014 Victims and Witnesses Act. The interpretation of these terms is already set out in law, including the Equality Act 2010, which contains single-sex exemptions whose use the Scottish Government has and continues to support where this is necessary and proportionately, such as in the case of forensic medical examinations. For that reason, changing the wording in the 2014 Victims Act makes no difference, as this amendment will not affect the operation of the underlying law here or the already established rights of women to request a female examiner. And for the same reason, whether the amendment passes or not, that does not, indeed could not, affect the rights of any other person involved in these vital services. Presiding Officer, in establishing the Government's position, I have of course consulted with my Cabinet Secretary colleagues, most importantly with Shirley-Ann Somerville as the Cabinet Secretary responsible for equalities. We are of one mind, we won't be opposing the amendment in this group, because it does not and cannot change the existing and established law, rights and practice in this area, which we will uphold.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. And can I call on Joanne Lamont to wind up and then to press and withdraw her amendment?
Thank you very much, and I intend obviously to press my amendment. Can I thank people who have contributed to this debate? And I would challenge all members who have reservations about it that they have a responsibility to raise their concerns, and so I appreciate those who have done so. I'm more concerned about people in this debate who are not saying anything, who are not engaged in the debate, but at the same time are calling into question my motives and the motives of those who have asked me to take this forward. If as a Parliament...
House Cole Hamilton.
I'm very grateful to Joanne Lamont for giving way. I believe that her remarks were directed at myself and my party, and that is in part down to the fact that we were wanting to listen to the debate as it unfolds. But I found the remarks of Andy Whiteman very compelling in terms of the range of propositions he laid out. So we will be opposing the amendment this evening.
Joanne Lamont.
My apologies. I actually quoted Alec Cole Hamilton's words in my own contribution at the beginning because I had found them so powerful. I was not actually talking about the Lib Dems because I recognise the pressure on time, but I am concerned that there are people who will not engage in the argument despite the seriousness of the issues. And I make that as a more general point and are content away from here and away from when we debate these things to make assertions and allegations which are simply not true. There is no one in here or anywhere else pretending that this legislation or this motion will transform women's lives. I wish it were true. I wish by the stroke of a pen in support of this amendment that the pain the women who spoke to the committee could be erased. Nobody is pretending that any legislation on its own changes the world. Our responsibility is not just to signal what we would like to happen, but to will the means for it to happen. And it's my profound belief that this amendment will make a difference because it will shift from saying, well, there aren't enough female examiners to asking the question, how do we make sure there are enough women examiners? And I respond also to my colleague and friend, Monica Lennon. Forgive me if I focus on survivors in this debate. We should centre the experience of survivors and ask what is right for traumatised women. These women are not responsible for what people say on Twitter or on Facebook. These are women and men who are not responsible for those who choose to weaponise every single bit of politics that this country seeks to defend or argue. These are women who are traumatised and have asked through the years that things should change, and over time they have, and we should listen to them now. And if people want to debate the definition of what a man is and a definition of what a woman is, if they want to look at the Equality Act and change it, I am more than happy to be party to that debate. But that is not the argument we're having now. This legislation deals with what is the reality now of what a woman is, what a man is, and, oh my goodness, what abuse and violence are too. And we owe it to them to reflect on that. And on the question of conflation, I've got huge amounts of respect for Andy Whiteman as someone who considers things in great detail, but he makes the point that the words sex and gender no longer are argued in the same way as interchangeable terms that they were at one time, and I gave evidence of that already. And what women need, and what survivor needs, and what the law demands is clarity, not signals, clarity. And Monica talked about the role of rape crisis. From the very time when I was a young woman who began to understand what violence meant against women, I worked with and supported women who were far more courageous than me in establishing women's aid refuges and establishing rape crisis centres. And we had to win the argument that it was right that these services should be provided to women only. And it wasn't an easy argument, but we won it. And we are back there now in this argument. If we are not prepared to say, as the Equality Act says, that there is a right to women-only spaces and women-only services, and these will be protected. Rape Crisis Scotland and Rape Crisis Centres at a local level have done immeasurable work to give voice to women, and those voices were heard in this debate. And my contention is that in supporting this small amendment, we are supporting the considered recommendation of a serious committee of this Parliament, and a committee that heard the voices of survivors and insisted that there would be change. It will not change everything, but it will give clarity to the rights of survivors that they can ask in their most traumatised moments for support for female examination that might make that trauma a little less. And I hope that the colleagues in the chamber will support me in that regard.
Thank you very much, Ms. Lamont. The question is that Amendment 28 be agreed to. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are not agreed. We are going to move to a vote, and members may cast their votes now. This will be a one-minute division.
One second, Polly McNeill.
That vote is now closed. If any members did have any difficulty, please let me know now. Point of order, Polly McNeill.
Yeah, at the last few seconds, it's came up that I haven't voted, but I didn't actually, wasn't asked to vote, and I would have voted yes to the amendment.
Thank you, Ms. McNeill. Your vote wasn't recorded, but I will make sure your vote is added and you voted yes. Point of order from Graeme Simpson. Graeme Simpson joined us remotely.
Yeah, presiding officer, I couldn't get connected. I would have voted yes.
Thank you, Mr. Simpson. That is noted, and that will be added to the voting roll. Thank you very much, Mr. Simpson. Thank you very much, colleagues. The result of the vote on amendment number 28 in the name of Joanne Lamont is yes 113, no 9. There was one abstention. The amendment is therefore agreed. Can I call amendment 29 in the name of the Cabinet Secretary? Cabinet Secretary to move.
Moved.
Thank you. The question is that amendment 29 be agreed to. Are we all agreed? Yes. We are agreed, and that ends consideration of amendments. Now, at this stage, as members will be aware, I have to decide whether or not, in my view, any provision of this bill relates to a protected subject matter. That is, whether it modifies the electoral system or franchise for the Scottish parliamentary elections. In the case of this bill, in my view, no provision does. Therefore, it does not need a supermajority to be passed at stage three. Thank you. We're going to move on to the next item of business. There'll just be a short pause. Could I urge all members to observe social distancing, wear their masks, and observe the one-way systems in the rest of the building when leaving the chamber. Thank you.
Well, you'll be pleased the final item of business is a debate on motion 23646 in the name of Jean Freeman on the Forensic Medical Services Victims of Sexual Abuse in Scotland Bill. I can invite members who wish to speak in the debate to press the request to speak button now. And I call on Jean Freeman to speak to and move the motion. Cabinet Secretary, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm pleased to open this stage three debate on a very important bill indeed. Rape and sexual assault are among the very worst experiences that any one of us can face in our life, and the impact lasts. There can be no question of that. This bill is one important part of what we have to do to make sure that in all we do, we put the victim first, that we recognise and understand the trauma and embed that recognition and the actions and approach that necessarily flow from that in the healthcare support and the support for recovery that we provide. Members may have watched a recent Scottish television segment on the bill where Katie Johnson and Lisa Walsh, two survivors of rape and sexual assault, bravely waived their right to anonymity and shared their experiences of forensic medical examination. To them and to the other survivors who have helped us so very greatly to get to this place, you have my undying gratitude for your courage and your honesty, There is no doubt at all that too many experiences of forensic examination in the past were poor and re-traumatising. The Chief Medical Officer's Rape and Sexual Assault Task Force has provided national leadership for the improvement of these services, following an important report by Her Majesty's Inspectorate of Constabulary in Scotland. I want to put on record my sincere thanks to Dr. Catherine Calderwood, our former CMO, for her leadership in driving that work forward, and to Dr. Gregor Smith, our current CMO, for continuing that focus. To take just one, but extremely important example of improvement, victims are no longer examined in police facilities. I'm pleased that Rape Crisis Scotland have recognised that a corner has been turned and that improvements are bedding in. This bill provides a legislative underpinning to ensure secured continued improvements for the future. Importantly, the bill makes it a requirement for all health boards to provide consistent access to self-referral across Scotland. This matters because we know from survivors that access to self-referral is important in giving people control over what happens to them at a time when that control feels like and has been taken away. The bill ensures access to healthcare and request for forensic medical examination without first making a report to the police. The Health and Sport Committee's security of the bill in stages 1 and 2 has unquestionably improved it. I commend the committee for its careful work in not only taking due evidence from health stakeholders, but also from justice and equality stakeholders and from survivors. As a result of amendments recommended by the committee and agreed unanimously at stage 2, the bill now more prominently enshrines a requirement for health boards to provide trauma-informed care, care that actively works to avoid re-traumatisation and is delivered to the National Health Improvement Scotland standards. Nothing in the bill prevents victims of any age from accessing healthcare and support ahead of a police report. To support health boards in that regard, a package of resources was launched by the task force on the 24th of November. This package includes Scotland's first adult clinical pathway and first children and young people clinical pathway, alongside new forms and data sets for all ages, establishing a more robust and consistent gathering of performance data than has ever been available in the past. A patient information leaflet has also been developed, setting out what people can expect during and following a forensic medical examination, and making it clear to the individual that they are in control of the process. And I'm grateful to People First for their important help in developing the easy-read summary of that leaflet. Key refinements to the bill prompted by the Health and Sport Committee also include a statutory requirement for Public Health Scotland to publish an annual report about the delivery of these services, and importantly, a new delegated power to allow the minimum age for accessing self-referral to be varied in the future, should that become justified by wider changes to legislation or guidance, and should this Parliament agree. In order to enable the successful implementation of self-referral services, the task force is advancing work on a robust self-referral protocol that will be submitted to the Lord Advocate for his approval. This protocol will set out the detailed procedures for how health boards will collect forensic evidence again in a way that gives control to victims while securing the integrity of evidence should the victim choose to report to the police at a later date. Presiding Officer, in the earlier amendment debate on those lodged by Margaret Mitchell, I announced an additional 0.5 million in this financial year to help improve the NHS response to child sexual abuse through the development of child and family support workers across Scotland and to support implementation of the children and young people's clinical pathway. I'm delighted to confirm that in addition to that investment, and subject to the Parliament's approval of next year's budget, the Scottish Government will commit a further £1 million to support the implementation of the bill should members pass it today. These two announcements bring our investment in improving forensic medical services to £10 million over 4 years. This is in addition to the Scottish Government's continued support for Rape Crisis Scotland and its National Advocacy Project, which will undoubtedly play an important role in the successful implementation of the bill. Presiding Officer, before I conclude, let me share with you some feedback from a survivor for which I have permission to share on their experience of attending an NHS Sexual Assault Response Coordination Service funded by the task force. The survivor said, "The staff supporting us were both very skilled, professional and empathetic. They helped us as a family work through the medical and emotional process. We knew they were always there when we needed them. I want to enshrine in legislation NHS delivered forensic medical services that are person-centred and compassionate, delivering quality of care and support in every case. Presiding Officer, I move that the Parliament agrees that the Forensic Medical Services Victims of Sexual Offences Scotland Bill be passed."
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. I now call Donald Cameron to open for the Conservatives. Mr Cameron.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. Can I begin by stating our support for this bill and also note the welcome financial commitments that the Cabinet Secretary just laid out in her speech, because, as others have said, this changes brought about by this bill will require financial underpinning. I'd like to begin by paying tribute to members, fellow colleagues on the Health and Sport Committee for their work in getting us to this point, and also the clerks of this committee. I've only been on that committee for a short period since September, and I was not present for the evidence gathering process for this bill. I have, however, read some of the powerful submissions that were received. And it was clear from the Stage 1 debate on this bill and Stage 2 process in the Health Committee that while this bill deals with very difficult issues, it has nevertheless brought considered, measured and deeply held thoughts and views to the issues which the bill raises. It is an immensely important piece of legislation in order to help support the victims of some of the worst crimes imaginable, and we will certainly be supporting the bill at decision time this evening when it is voted upon. However, it is important that we do not stop here in our drive to improve the rights and experiences of victims of crime, particularly victims of sexual offences, because there are still injustices that exist. But many of those arguments are for another time. I want to turn to some of the remarks that I made at Stage 1 and reflect on whether or not these have been properly considered over the course of the passage of this bill through Parliament. At Stage 1, I noted the comments from the committee report on the issue of trauma-informed care and need to make it clear in the bill, Deputy Presiding Officer, that it should recognise the impact of trauma on an individual's health and their social and emotional well-being, as well as delivering services which minimise further trauma. And I am pleased that the Scottish Government recognised the importance of this and made amendments to the bill to that effect. I also noted in that Stage 1 debate the need to consider out-of-hours care and how that is delivered, particularly considering the delays experienced by many victims of sexual offences. And I note that the Cabinet Secretary provided some clarity over how out-of-hours care would be provided. But I feel that the reduction of these delays must be prioritised if this bill passes later today, as we expect it to do so. Consideration must also be given, Deputy Presiding Officer, to how provision of forensic examination services are given to victims who live in rural and remote areas, such as our island communities. That can often be logistically challenging and involve days of travelling, with victims unable to wash or change clothes, and clearly that can cause significant trauma. And I represent, of course, the Highlands and Islands, so that is a particularly pertinent point for me, and I hope the government looks at this further if the bill passes. This has been touched on already in the amendment stage this afternoon. Many of the statements from witnesses have spoken about the need to increase access to female doctors as a means to reduce trauma, and as Rape Crisis Scotland note, around 60% of forensic doctors in Scotland are female, compared to 30% in 2017. Now, that is plainly welcome. But they go on to note that there are still not enough women carrying out forensic examinations for rape survivors to be guaranteed access to a female doctor. And that is, it seems to me, a hugely important point for the government to not only acknowledge, but to seek to change. I don't intend to dwell on the amendment of Joanne Lamont that has just been passed. I am very glad it was passed, and it accords with what the Health Committee themselves stated in their report. I want to turn lastly to my colleague Margaret Mitchell and her amendments, which one of which succeeded, one of which did not. At stage one, we noted the need for self-referral to exist in a consistent way across Scotland. We also backed the calls to reduce the age of self-referral from 16 to 13 to encourage greater self-referral from younger people, given that 40% of last year's 13,000 sexual assaults were committed against under 18s. Now, we recognise the position of the Cabinet Secretary that changes to the minimum age of self-referral should be carried out through affirmative regulations as well as through proper consultation. And we note her amendment at stage two to create a new delegated power to allow for a future review of the age of referral. And we welcome this change. But we were also strongly of the view, as Margaret Mitchell set out, that this should be reviewed regularly and that there should be a reporting function in the bill. And we are glad, therefore, of course, that Margaret Mitchell's Amendment 1 succeeded in gaining the agreement of the Chamber, and grateful for the support of others. Amendment 7 regretfully did not succeed, but the point was made about the fact that it was a pilot scheme and there was a choice, but I don't intend to rehearse those arguments. In conclusion, Deputy Presiding Officer, I want to reiterate the support of the Scottish Conservatives for this important bill. I look forward to hearing other contributions from colleagues across the chamber. This bill has been immeasurably improved at all parliamentary stages of its passage. And I hope today too we have improved this bill further to the benefit of those who sadly may need to access such services in the future. Thank you.
Thank you, Mr. Cameron. I now call David Stewart to open for Labour. Mr. Stewart, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer, and I'm very pleased to be opening for Labour on this important and significant bill. Labour will be supporting the bill at decision time, and I'm convinced that parliamentarians across the political divide will recognise that the bill puts the needs of victims of sexual abuse as the key priority of forensic services. If I were to encapsulate the benefits of the bill in one word, then it would be empowerment, returning to the survivor some semblance of retaking control after the horror and humiliation of abuse in whatever unacceptable form it takes. Many years before I joined Parliament, I worked for over a decade running a very busy child protection team in an area of social deprivation. However, this comprehensive and frontline experience did not prepare me for the roundtable event organised by the Health and Sport Committee staff with survivors and victims. The survivors and the organisations that represented them spoke of the horror and anguish that they faced reporting their attack. There was a wide range of comments, but there was an underlying consistency in their message that, in their words, criminal procedure, forensic examinations of the attack, and that the system does not function correctly. A strong theme was the need for change, particularly of self-referral for forensic medical examination and for independent advocacy and psychological support. The aim, as we've heard, of the bill is to require health boards to make forensic medical examinations available on a self-referral basis to people aged over 16. This means victims will be able to undergo a forensic examination directly without a requirement to initially go to the police. In 2017, there was calls by the Inspector of Constabulary to review the contract between Police Scotland and NHS Scotland for the provisions of healthcare and forensic medical services. The review highlighted significant disparity in the forensic healthcare services being provided to victims of sexual crime. The key findings were there's a greater need for increased innovation, especially in relation to rural and island communities. There must be more collaboration among boards to share specialist staff, and a need to develop the role of specialist nurses in support of victims of sexual crime. But there is a gap in the service provision where the victim of a sexual crime seeks support and medical attention, but may wish not to report it to the police. Both Children First and NSPCC Scotland, of course, support self-referral 16 and argue that children under 16 will automatically be considered under the child protection in pathway. In tandem with this, the United Nations Convention of Rights of the Child will be incorporated into Scots law, and the Scottish Government are preparing new child protection guidance to reflect this. In any case, the Scottish Government appear, in my own assessment, to be keeping the door open to reduce the age of self-referral in the future as circumstances allow through delegated powers. But of course, self-referral will only benefit victims if they're aware of it as an option. And the Royal College of Nursing were right in their submission that there needs to be a focus on ensuring public awareness of the provisions of the bill. I'd like to ask the Minister in her closing remarks to outline the strategy for public information and education. Particular thought needs to be given around the quality of access to information and services to those with learning disabilities and same-sex victims. The committee, which I'm a member of, made a strong recommendation on this point. The key is informed consent, and the quality of access, including factors such as travel, rurality and low population density. It's vitally important that vulnerable young victims, who are very likely to be badly shocked and traumatised, have a statutory right to the independent advocacy across Scotland. It's important to stress that the bill that does not give the individual a right to forensic medical examination because they're carried out on the professional judgment of a healthcare professional. As the Stage 1 report made clear, professional judgment can include both clinical and non-clinical elements, supported by guidance from the Faculty of Forensic and Legal Medicine. Unfortunately, the shortage of female forensic examiners is a real practical problem, and we need to have a goal of a change in workforce planning, as Joanne Lamont very articulately stated in her amendment, which I welcome and I support. The Fairer Scotland Duty Assessment, the Bill notes that women, and indeed men, in lower socioeconomic groups are more likely to be the victims of sexual offending, and thus more likely to benefit from the bill. NHS Lanarkshire uses data collection, along with advice from the third sector, to target resources in areas of deprivation. And this reflects the committee's recommendation to require all health boards to capture and publish data addressing equality of access. So in conclusion, Presiding Officer, this is an important bill in protecting the healthcare needs of victims of sexual offences. We must listen to the voices of survivors. We need a criminal justice system that puts victims squarely on central court, a system that does not re-victimise, where victims are listened to, respected and supported. As one survivor said, violators cannot live with the truth. Survivors cannot live without it. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr Stewart. And I call John Finney to open for the Green Party. Mr Finney, please.
Thank you very much indeed, Presiding Officer. And we all know that legislation must be seen to be making things better. This legislation very clearly does. And although my party wasn't represented in the committee, I'd like to thank the committee. I'd like to thank the genesis of this, the Magistrates Inspector of Constabulary report, Scottish Government team, the committee team, all those who provided evidence and briefings, and particularly, and I know from my experience in the Justice Committee, the private testimony of survivors, how humbling that is for members to receive that, and how informative it can be. So I also commend the Scottish Government's Victim Task Force, which the joint chairs are Rape Crisis Scotland and Scottish Women's Aid. It's taken by a briefing we received from the Law Society, which I'd like to quote from Presiding Officer. It says, as the bill reaches the final stage of its parliamentary process, it's important that in achieving its policy objective, a balance must be maintained in the interaction of the various interests. They then go on to list them, one of them being public law, and we must endeavour to increase the reporting of sexual crimes. And I believe, for instance, that the self-referral provisions in the bill will help with that. We also must secure more convictions for sexual prosecutions. And I believe that the victim-centred approach that this bill encourages can only help. Well, society also talk about private law and respecting the individual privacy and autonomy. And of course, there are some fundamental individual rights at stake here. The individual and the right to make choices regarding reporting and the right to have their privacy respected. And I really like the Cabinet Secretary's phrase, they are in control. And that, of course, is about the timing and the location. And we do know And as someone familiar with cold police stations, I welcome the fact that there's respect being shown for victims and that their appropriate facilities are being provided. And of course, there's an obligation on the state, which I think this legislation very clearly addresses, and that is to provide a humane regime capable of providing redress to the victims of crime. Healthcare, of course, is another factor. And well-being, of course, isn't simply the physical health of people. And I welcome increasing recognition across a lot of our discussions about the benefits of good mental health and the public agencies' interaction with the third sector partners in providing support to victims is going to be very, very important. I also thought it was very telling that the Law Society very honestly said the importance of training, which includes the legal sector, for ensuring that all are aware of the provisions and the importance of supporting them. Now, previously, of course, work was carried out by police surgeons. Then it was outsourced, a bad idea and one that disadvantaged rural communities. This memorandum of understanding doesn't completely remove the challenges of rurality that my colleague Donald Cameron referred to, and we must be aware of the challenges that gives. But in the short term I have, I want to say that the holistic approach to care will bring better results, not only for the well-being of the victim, but will also increase what we really do need to see, and that is a significant improvement in the number of successful prosecutions. And that will perhaps come about because the complainer feels supported, but also because of the provisions of the acquisition of the evidence and the quality and continuity of that evidence is referred to in all the reports. That's hugely important. So I warmly welcome what I think the Cabinet Secretary said was person-centred and compassionate legislation. And as I said at the outset, at decision time tonight, the Scottish Green Party will be supporting it. Thank you very much indeed.
Thank you very much, Mr Finney. I call Alec Cole-Hamilton, open for Liberal Democrats. Mr Cole-Hamilton.
Thank you very much indeed, Presiding Officer. Before I begin, I just want to pay tribute for a final time to the witnesses who came to our committee, who told us of their personal experience in very, very harrowing terms. This may be the last time I speak of their experiences in the context of this bill, but it will not be the last time I think of them, and I will carry their stories with me. We did a lot of work in the foothills of this legislation, and it has been very necessary. It's a very complex and technical piece of legislation. It aims, since its inception, or it should have been, and it has succeeded in that, to give voice and rights to the people who've been through some of the most horrific crimes imaginable. When speaking on this bill in an earlier debate, I voiced my concerns about the minimum age of self-referral being 16. This has been quite an ongoing debate throughout this passage of this bill, and I referred to the concerns of Children First, specifically that the bill risks excluding those under 16 from vital services that the passing of this bill will provide. We know that children under 16 are likely, when they are assaulted, are most likely to be assaulted by a family member or someone they know. And last year, 40% of sexual assaults were against those under 18. I'm sure I echo the sentiments of the whole chamber when I say that these figures are both devastating and shocking, deeply shocking. And a member put forward earlier at stage two sought to move the minimum age of self-referral from 16 to 13. And it's an amendment that reluctantly my party voted against. We had a lot of sympathy with that. But we voted against this amendment because we recognise the concerns put forward by the Cabinet Secretary at the time surrounding child protection, and because the Cabinet Secretary has signalled that she is willing to give thought to this. And I am very glad we have made at least some progress in that area today. But in order for us to make adequate progress, to realise the rights of all child victims so that they too can have access to clinical and forensic pathways which are suited to them, then we need to properly implement an innovative Barnahus House-led approach, which I know the Cabinet Secretary has shown support for, not just in stage two, but in many other debates in this chamber. The Scottish Government does claim that this bill and associated clinical pathway are Barnahus ready, yet they have not yet still offered a clear commitment or details or funding for the national rollout of a Barnahus-led scheme, similar to the pilot we've seen in the west of Scotland led by Children First. And I'd be grateful to the Cabinet Secretary if she could signal to the Chamber her views on how we might better support and indeed fund that national Barnahus initiative. This bill, Presiding Officer, is so important. It answers in many ways the challenges set out to our committee on that early Tuesday morning, many, many months ago, when we met and heard their testimony and were gripped by its candour, its bravery, and the depth of its feeling. It means that those people will not be pulled into a system that they are not ready for. It means that they will have the time and the space to consider reporting an assault to the police without losing vital evidence. It will offer autonomy to those who have suffered in a way that has seen control of their body completely robbed of them. Presiding Officer, I'll close with this. Sexual assault is one of the most horrific crimes in the world. It has happened to people very, very close to me. And no victim should be excluded from receiving compassionate aftercare, especially not children and young people. The complex way in which children and young people process traumatic events requires an approach specifically tailored to their needs, and that is what Barnhouse offers. I passionately support this bill and all its ambitions on the basis that the Scottish Government has already made clear that it has a commitment to ensuring that child victims of sexual assault are not excluded from these pathways and that we find an appropriate approach for them. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Mr. Cole Hamilton. Open debate, 4 minute speeches, please. Sandra White, followed by Liam Kerr.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer. As a member of the Health Committee, I do welcome the opportunity to contribute to the final stages of this bill. I also, like others, want to thank the clerks of the committee and people who have given, professionals, groups who have given evidence, and the many organisations also. But most of all, want to thank the women who came forward and gave evidence to us. Like Cole Hamilton had said, it was quite a harrowing experience, obviously for them as well as us. And the strength, courage and bravery they showed giving us this evidence, it really enabled us to move forward with this bill. And I really sincerely thank them for that. And I hope, I'm sure this bill will pass tonight and it will be a testimony and a tribute to their bravery coming forward and giving us this evidence. The bill is hugely important. It confirms and delivers our commitment to improve the way that health and justice systems support sexual crime. That's always been something which has been raised on numerous occasions. And it is pertinent that during the consultation process, 91% of respondents agreed that health boards should provide this service. And it does provide a service which is holistic healthcare and it puts victims first, and that's important also. And apart from that, putting victims first, it also enshrines in law health board responsibility for the operations of forensic medical services. And it will provide a legal framework, which is important also, to ensure that consistent access to self-referral is available across Scotland. It's extremely important in addressing the problems in the system, which was raised by us, by survivors, and first and foremost, the access to services was very important. The professionals involved in the system, the organisations who offer valuable and crucial support to victims, also raised a number of areas which I think this bill has covered. There were two significant areas. One we have covered, and that's about access to female doctors. We have already covered that with the amendment. One of the other areas was access to forensic examination as quickly as possible. When we heard the evidence from the survivors waiting in police offices for hours on end, not being able to change their clothes, not being given support, not being able to have anyone with them when they were there, not being able to get a cup of tea or coffee or anything to drink. It was quite harrowing. And I think this bill actually really, really looks at that in regards to the fact that they will no longer have to do that. And that is basically a human right. You shouldn't be sitting in a cold, dark place. And it ensures that the bill will ensure that the victims of these horrendous crimes don't have to go through that additional trauma. Now, lots has been said about access to female examiners, and I do welcome some of the progress that has been on. At the moment, we have 118 sexual offences examiners. 70% of them are women. And I know we're moving on further. We're actually looking at 20 priority places on a new postgraduate course at Queen Margaret University in Edinburgh. And that starts January 21, which is in a month's time, basically. That is good news, but we must ensure that when a woman asks for a woman examiner, then they are available to her. And I suppose that's a big ask, but it's one of the biggest asks that we were put forward to us during the committee stages. In conclusion, presiding officer, I believe, and not just me, but everyone, I think, the bill is fundamental in ensuring that all victims of sexual assault and rape are treated with dignity, compassion and respect. And I thank everyone for taking part in this debate and for the committee and everyone else for looking at the evidence provided. Thank you, Presiding Officer.
Thank you, Ms White. And I call Liam Kerr to be followed by Lewis MacDonald.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. I'm very pleased to speak in favour of and later to vote to pass the Forensic Medical Services Bill. This is a really important piece of legislation which seeks to make the process of medical examination easier for victims of sexual crime and to transform survivors' experiences of healthcare following sexual violence. It is long overdue, and response to the conclusions of the HMICS report that forensic medical services in Scotland have been patchy, inconsistent, and at times arguably traumatising, concluding victims have been let down. I think we all sincerely hope that this bill succeeds. Much of that will be to do with resources, and at stage one I flagged that the financial memorandum reflects the estimated 10% increase in additional forensic medical examinations. I have no idea whether that will prove to be correct, but I don't see similar provision in the financial memorandum for other aspects of the bill. There's only a rather throwaway line that the Scottish Government considers the costs on the third sector to support the bill's implementation will be modest. And a supplementary financial memorandum, which deals only with the cost to Public Health Scotland of the annual report. Now that concerns me, because logically what isn't resourced can't be provided. And I worry that if this bill is actually about a complete overhaul in the response to these matters, I fear it will cost a significant amount of money on an ongoing basis, which might not have been provided for. But I do welcome the Cabinet Secretary's remarks earlier on about an additional £1 million being allocated to this bill, and acknowledge that these issues are clearly in her mind and in her thinking. The other issue I know many respondents flagged is the lack of access to female doctors. According to Rape Crisis Scotland, this is the single most pressing and important issue that requires to be addressed. The bill contains a provision for victims of sexual offences to be given the opportunity to request that the person who is to carry out a forensic medical examination be of a specified sex. And I associate myself with Donald Cameron's comments in this regard earlier. That's all well and good, but presumably when someone complaining of rape, for example, asks for a female doctor, whether they get one will depend on whether there's one on rota at that time. Presumably if there isn't, they'll be given the option of going ahead with a male doctor or waiting until a female doctor is working. I'm sure we all noted particularly the evidence supplied to MSPs last night from HEAL, a survivors group. In one passage, which I thought particularly hard-hitting, they suggested that survivors who are unable to tolerate male examiners giving them an intimate examination when they are newly traumatised and wounded to the core of their being often face long waits until a female examiner is available. My understanding is that prior to the examination, complainants are strongly encouraged not to wash, to drink, to eat, as vital evidence could be lost. So what kind of choice is that, really? So recruitment and training of female forensic doctors must be prioritised. And in fact, as Monica Lennon said earlier today, increasing the numbers is where our focus must be. And I accept that in answer to Sandra White and in the Stage 1 debate, the Cabinet Secretary referred to a new course and associated funding for forensic nurse examiners at Queen Margaret University. This is good and reflects the Cabinet Secretary's stated aim to ensure that we provide 24/7 access to female examiners should that be what an individual wants. But leaving aside the inevitable time lag until qualification and deployment, the question begged is whether this is sufficient, and if not, when that aim will actually be met. And perhaps in closing, the Cabinet Secretary can address how confident she is that there are sufficient places to address the need and achieve that 24/7 access. and also perhaps whether she would agree to a regular report back to Parliament on progress in the recruitment and training in achieving that goal, perhaps in the Mitchell report that went through today or the NHS Scotland report at Section 11A. But in any event, with that, I reiterate my support for the Forensic Medical Services Bill and look forward to voting for it at decision time tonight.
Thank you very much, Mr Kerr. I call Lewis MacDonald to be followed by Emma Harper. Ms Harper is the last speaker in the open debate.
Thank you very much. I am glad to speak in support of this bill as it nears its completion of its progress through Parliament. It is fair to say that there were times when such a positive outcome seemed a little less than certain. As convener of the Health and Sport Committee, I have had plenty of opportunities to consider the interaction of government and Parliament over the last 3 years. This has, of course, been a year like no other. Back in March, as we have heard, members of the committee met with survivors of rape and sexual abuse. It was both a sobering and a heartening experience. Women who had suffered sexual violence by men talked about being traumatised again by what happened when they reported the crime. Some felt that so strongly that they told us they might not have gone to the police if they had known what would happen next. The heartening bit was the courage and the commitment to other victims to be there, to come forward informally and privately, but directly to members of this Parliament to share their experience and to ask us to make the system better. This bill does that. It puts victims at the centre. It changes the forensic medical examination of those victims from being a matter for the police service to being a matter for the health service. It allows those who have been raped or sexually assaulted to refer themselves for examination without having to report a crime to the police first. It provides that women who are raped should be able to say that their forensic medical examiner should be a woman too. It provides choice for all victims, and it requires services to all victims to be delivered in a trauma-informed way. The women we met and the voluntary organisations which worked with them did not ask for change for its own sake. They asked for change for the sake of future victims, to make the system more sensitive and more responsive to their needs. Some had found police officers to be caring and compassionate and understanding. Some praised the skills and the empathy of male medical examiners. But having women instead of men in those roles was still their strongest single demand, and focusing on the health and well-being of victims first was even more important than bringing the perpetrators to justice. We took that evidence in March. We then also met some of the government officials working on the bill. Then along came COVID-19, and for a few weeks, the process of taking evidence on the bill was knocked sideways, and the progress of the bill itself seemed in doubt. But the upshot of that uncertainty was that the bill did go forward. Like Parliament as a whole, the Health and Sport Committee went online to hear from expert witnesses in May and June and obtained fresh written submissions from other experts on the back of those online evidence sessions. That progress of legislation in difficult circumstances is a credit to all those in the health service, the police service, the voluntary sector and elsewhere who were committed to the proposed change in the law and adapted to the new normal to make it happen. It is also a credit to the ability of government and Parliament to work together in the face of adversity when there is a shared objective to be met. I would like to acknowledge the Cabinet Secretary's personal commitment to this bill and also the support across the Chamber for a long overdue reform affecting people's lives. As has been well said this afternoon, changing the law is not enough. There needs to be awareness of the new system on the part of those who can help, and there need to be resources to make change happen. But a change in the law is a good place to start, and I will be delighted to vote for this bill today.
Thank you very much, Ms MacDonald. I call Emma Harper, please.
Thank you, Presiding Officer. The importance of this bill cannot be overstated. In Scotland, 4% of women and 1% of men have experienced serious sexual assault since the age of 16. The bill is a landmark piece of legislation. It's hugely important for survivors of sexual crime, and it allows far greater choice for survivors of sexual abuse. As Deputy Convener of the Parliament's Health and Sport Committee, and as someone who has cared for and treated survivors of rape when I worked as a nurse, I welcome the opportunity to speak in this debate. And I too, as others have mentioned, want to thank the work of everyone who has contributed to the bill, the clerks, the members of the committee, Rape Crisis Scotland and the CMO's task force, and of course the survivors who powerfully and bravely spoke at our Parliament evidence session. At Health and Sport Committee, we've held 7 evidence sessions on the bill, including with the survivors of sexual violence, and received 38 submissions to our call for evidence from survivors and the representative organisations from justice and legal service providers. One of the key themes we looked at and agreed to with the Scottish Government, as affirmed at Stage 2, is the need for survivors of sexual offences to have improved access to forensic medical services. The bill will let survivors refer themselves to their health board for an examination rather than a police station. This is significant. They will not have to go to the police first, so changing from a law enforcement environment, which can be very intimidating and very frightening, to a holistic healthcare environment, which will reduce stress, stigma, fear and anxiety. This gives people who have gone through this horrible, traumatic, terrible experience, I'll give them time to decide if they want to report an incident to the police without losing any vital evidence. One thing that has been mentioned is Donald Cameron mentioned out-of-hours availability of forensic examiners, and Sandra White spoke about the early access in order to gather forensic evidence. But there was a small piece of evidence that was given to me by the local rape crisis team, which I raised at committee, that self-referral numbers were higher on a Tuesday between 12 o'clock and 4 o'clock. And this may not make specific evidence gathering. It might make it difficult to gather specific evidence, but as out of hours is vitally important to provide for adequate staffing, I'd be keen to hear whether monitoring the self-referral of date, day and time will actually take process, or whether that's just an anomaly that happened in the early information gathering part of this whole process. The welcome steps to improving the overall experience for survivors of sexual offences is excellent, and the evidence that was presented at committee made it clear that female victims prefer female practitioners, and we heard more about that previously. But it is worth repeating that there has been more forensic female practitioners in the last couple of years, both trained and as medical doctors as well, and 68 nurses now have been trained, which is great as they can help support the whole forensic medical exam process. So we are moving in the right direction, and I commend the NHS Scotland and the Scottish Government and partners for this positive action. In Dumfries and Galloway, I was pleased to see the development of the new forensic medical suite based at Mountain Hall Treatment Centre in Dumfries. It's one of the rural areas that was spoke about by Dave Stewart. Last year, I was invited to see the suite for myself. I was able to have the whole process explained to me, and I also met the staff of Rape Crisis to gain an understanding of the varied needs of people who have endured sexual assault and rape. The forensic medical examiners who work in this suite are trained in trauma-informed care, and the team is working to ensure that victims of rape and sexual assault endure as little stress, stigma and anxiety as possible. So in conclusion, Presiding Officer, I fully support this important and significant bill. It's hugely important for survivors of sexual crime, and encourage everyone to support the bill this evening. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Ms Harper. And I call on Pauline McNeill to close for Labour. Ms McNeill, please.
This is clearly one of the most important pieces of legislation that we've seen in this Parliament for all women and men who've been the victims of rape and sexual assault. I'd like to thank all the members of the committee and the Parliament who've contributed to making this a stronger piece of legislation. And the speeches from Emma Harper, Sandra White and Lewis MacDonald, I think, strengthened the quality of this debate. It is widely accepted reality that many sexual offences are not reported to the police, and there are many reasons why people will hesitate to report sexual assaults. Fear of having to relive an event, a concern that you will not be believed. Many victims of rape and sexual assault, of course, blame themselves. Some victims feel guilty because they didn't fight back. They may even blame themselves for trusting someone in the first place, but victims are never to blame. But it's up to us, and it's a duty on us as parliamentarians, to create the right conditions for victims, whoever they are. That's men and women, all women, who come forward to require to undergo necessary and intimate harrowing physical examination to provide evidence should he decide to go forward. For many women, that examination is traumatising and painful on many levels. The bill will make forensic medical examination available on a self-referral basis, crucially with no requirement to report it to Police Scotland, a very significant development in our criminal justice system. I was shocked when I read that 40% of last year's 13,000 sexual assaults were on under 18s, which means that over 5,000 children reported being sexually assaulted last year. The Scottish Labour welcomes the amendments at stage two that provided the option of lowering the age of self-referral in the future. But we must make victims aware of these provisions, of course. Amendment 28, now passed, lodged by Joanne Lamon, seeks to change the wording of the Victims and Witnesses Act of 214, that individuals undergo an examination would have the right to choose the sex of the examiner as opposed to the gender. And 113 members of this Parliament agreed. The sex of the examiner was raised as an issue that was very important to the victims of sexual abuse and rape, and that was raised at the very beginning of the Stage 1 report. This change in wording from gender to sex was a recommendation of the committee at stage one following evidence gathered from survivors about the re-traumatising nature of the examination and how the lack of access to a female doctor was the most important thing needing addressed. NHS Lanarkshire commented that the patient's choice of sex of forensic examiner must be guaranteed by this legislation. Rape Crisis provided a briefing for the members of the Parliament today, said that the single most important complaint we hear from survivors of sexual crime about their experience of forensic examination is about the lack of female doctors, and I agree. In their briefing, they rightly point out that changing the term from gender to sex will not guarantee a female doctor. I still found it puzzling that the conclusion to be drawn is that there was no requirement to change the bill. Like many other members, I've had emails, and I have to say none of them have been abusive at all. And I would like to point out that, of course, when we talk about victims, we talk about all victims. That's trans women, that's men. But most of the people who wrote to me were women and rape survivors, and who say that rape survivors need to know that when they are torn and bleeding, that they will not be pressurised into accepting intimate touch from a strange male. And Heal a Survivors group said, even as survivors, we were met with accusations of bigotry and hatefulness, as well as threats of violence when we express our need for female-only provisions in publicity. So I think we have removed that ambiguity in law and provided clarity for those women. I believe this has been a dignified debate, and I think it's important it continues to be a dignified debate, because I think we all agree that the way forward is to increase the number of female doctors. And we know we're a long way to go in that, but that's really what I think every single person in this Parliament, in this debate, has said. And that's, of course, what the Government have committed to. And with that, I'm delighted to support the bill this evening on behalf of Scottish Labour.
Thank you very much, Ms McNeill. Now I call on Brian Whittle to close with the Conservatives. Mr Whittle.
Thank you, Deputy Presiding Officer. I'm pleased to be able to close this debate on behalf of the Scottish Conservatives. And I, like others, would like to start by thanking all those victims of sexual abuse who very bravely gave evidence to the committee, moved us all, and have really helped to shape this very important bill. And this bill is incredibly important, and for me, it's the start of a process in considering the plight of the victims first and foremost, as Donald Cameron said in his opening speech. Now, I very purposely say start a process because it's but one point in many that needs addressed if we are truly going to change the way in which victims of sexual crimes are treated. The bill can be a message to those who have suffered that Parliament, the law, society is prepared to start listening to them, believe them, and will set out a path that begins to tackle that issue of re-traumatisation. I would note here that next week we also have a debate on the redress scheme for survivors of historical child sex abuse in care homes. And it's, again, I think it's the start of a journey in recognising the serious flaws in the system for victims in the cases where there are sexual crimes. But I will again next week no doubt say I don't think it goes far enough. But why is this bill so crucial?
Well, a meta-analysis of 28 studies of women and girls aged 14 and over who had non-consensual sex obtained through force, threat or incapacitation found that 60% of these victims didn't acknowledge that they had been raped. It's common for victims to need time to acknowledge what's happened to them. It's a gradual process with an indicator of post-traumatic stress disorder and avoiding reminders of the trauma. So having the ability to self-refer without reporting a crime while assimilating what has happened to them is a significant positive step forward. But I want to highlight a couple of issues. Firstly, the debate I mentioned the last time at stage two around record keeping and retention of samples. And I would say, though, again, that during that evidence session, the Cabinet Secretary suggesting that at least initially the records would be kept in a paper format is something that needs to be addressed quickly. That aside, I would suggest that the timescale for destruction of evidence being set at 2 years and 2 months is arbitrary. I think victims and victim support groups suggest that the period should be much longer. Retention periods must be based on the purposes for the retention, and, for example, linking of forensic evidence with related case records, although I do also recognise the Cabinet Secretary's acknowledgement that this will be revisited. I think the bill could have set a precedence for getting records retention and wider records management requirements right within legislation, a key aspect of compliance with an implementation of legislation and the exercising of people's rights set out within legislation lies in the creation and retention of records. And I did say at stage two, I recommended the input of records management expertise via a memorandum of understanding with the Keeper of the Records of Scotland in drawing up new and amendments to existing legislation. The second point really is to Margaret Mitchell's amendments, and I think it's around around limiting the age group who can self-refer being 16 and above. And I do think there is no standard maturity for 16-year-olds to start with. And I have the opinion that this law has been suggested to me might fall foul of UNCRC legislation. I think GIRFEC is surely about getting it right for every child. I'm not sure we're quite there yet. I do recognise and welcome the government moving to a regular review of the age at which self-referral will start, and also welcome the Cabinet Secretary's commitment and investment in support of child sexual abuse. We do need to afford appropriate rights to those under 16. So in conclusion, Deputy Presiding Officer, I finish where I started in stating that this is a crucial and important piece of legislation, not just because of its content, but because of a potential statement of intent to all those who have suffered trauma of sexual abuse, for all those who fear stigmatisation, that this Parliament is waking up to the fact that their journey in far too many cases is appalling, and the way in which the system is set up is largely responsible for this crime being mainly unreported and why there are so few convictions. The bill is very welcome, but I also can't help feeling that it's an opportunity missed to make a significantly greater impact that future legislation will have to pick up and deal with. Parliament should also consider how to connect up other legislation pertaining to a victim's journey to accept that for some the journey of a victim falls well short of decency, and to accept that the support offered to victims is often unsatisfactory. If Parliament had been a tad braver, I believe we could have made even progress in the way in which we deal with these abhorrent crimes. This has been an injustice for such a long time in the way victims of sexual abuse have been treated by the system. This is a very welcome start, and we at the Scottish Conservatives will obviously support the bill, but I also can't help feeling there's an opportunity missed. Deputy Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much, Mr Whittle. And I call on Jean Freeman to close to the Scottish Government. Cabinet Secretary, please.
Thank you very much, Presiding Officer, and I'm grateful to members for what has been a very important debate full of powerful and important contributions. I will only have time to respond to one or two. But before I do, what I do welcome, as I did in the Stage 1 debate, is the strong support for this bill across parties and committees of this Parliament. The Parliament is uniting as one to signal that victims must have access to NHS-led healthcare and forensic medical services, whether they choose to report to the police or not. And I believe it is uniting too to send a clear message to victims of some of the worst crimes possible. You matter, your voices count, and we care. I want to turn, Presiding Officer, to some of the points that have been made. I would never, ever say that we have finished in the progress that we've made, but I do think it is important to recognise some of the progress that has been made, but partly by government support, but critically by listening to survivors and to the work of our NHS staff and boards. We've made progress of increasing 30% since 2017 in the number of female sexual offence examiners. We now have two nurse sexual offence examiners qualified and experienced. And as has been mentioned by others, 20 priority places on a new and very important postgraduate qualification in advanced forensic practice at Queen Margaret University, which begins next month. All of that is critical to ensuring the multidisciplinary approach that will allow us to ensure that the right to choose a female forensic examiner is one that can be delivered. It is the case, as I said earlier, Presiding Officer, that in the second quarter of this year, 75% of examinations carried out was carried out by female examiners and within the three-hour time frame that national standards require. That is progress, but it is not enough progress yet. Mr. Cameron and others quite rightly made the point that there's no point in this legislation if victims don't know about it. The task force is taking forward work right now on a national awareness-raising campaign, and work is underway to establish a national telephony access to self-referral through NHS 24. On Barnhouse, government has agreed that work that was necessarily paused on the Barnhouse standards will restart so that draft standards can be consulted on next year. And the Public Health Scotland's statutory annual report, now in this bill, will provide important information on scrutiny that will allow scrutiny on the progress on a number of the issues that members have expressed legitimate and correct concerns about, including the number of female examiners and how well we meet that three-hour time frame. In my remaining time, Presiding Officer, I would like to repeat my thanks to the Health and Sport Committee, to its convener, to members past and present, and the clerks for their thorough work on the bill, which we can all agree has improved it immeasurably. In particular, the committee's scrutiny has resulted in greater prominence for the need of trauma-informed care, and that care that avoids re-traumatisation. I'd also like to thank the Delegated Powers and Law Reform Committee, the Finance Committee and the Scottish Parliament Information Centre for their work on the bill. I want to thank Rape Crisis Scotland and the very many stakeholders who have inspired and helped to develop and improve the bill. The healthcare professionals and wider staff of the Sexual Assault Response Coordination Services in Scotland for all their hard work that has led to much improvement, and as I said earlier, to our Interim Chief Medical Officer, Dr. Smith, for his continued leadership of this important work throughout a COVID-19 pandemic, and to all the members of his task force. Their expert advice has helped to shape the improvements we're now seeing in health wards across Scotland. And of course, I want to thank the Bill team, who have been quite extraordinary in the thoroughness with which they have approached their task, the degree to which they have reached out to stakeholders far and wide, and the quality of the information that they have given me and enabled me to understand so much of what it is that we are doing and we need to do. As I said yesterday in a meeting with them, I am merely their front woman. All the credit for the quality of this legislation, aside from to all the others that I've mentioned, goes to that team. But most of all, I want to extend my personal thanks to the survivors who've shared their personal experience. And in doing so, have not only increased our understanding of the impact of these crimes, but shaped this legislation. One of the most important things in this bill for me is the enshrining of trauma-informed care. And I want to quote, if I may, from a book called The Body Keeps the Score, from Van der Kolk in 2014. Trauma is not remembered as a story with a narrative, a beginning, a middle, and an end, but isolated sensory imprints, images, sound and physical sensations, accompanied by intense emotions, usually terror and helplessness. Those survivors experience that trauma, but they had the courage and the honesty to step forward and inform this Parliament and its members about what is needed. Presiding Officer, in the Stage 1 debate, I said I wasn't interested in legislation unless it can be implemented. And we now have a bill whose implementation in the course of this next year will be taken forward by that Chief Medical Officer Rape and Sexual Assault Task Force, backed by clinical pathways and other resources and supported by the additional investment I announced earlier. Most importantly, it will be a bill that will be scrutinised, challenged and considerably improved as we respond in kind to the courage and honesty of those survivors. I invite the Parliament to pass the Forensic Medical Services Bill to guarantee all victims in Scotland access to self-referral and trauma-informed care, and to confirm our collective agreement and commitment that in Scotland we will put the healthcare needs of victims first.
Thank you very much, Cabinet Secretary. Well, that concludes the debate on the Forensic Medical Services Victims of Sexual Offences Scotland Bill, and it's now time to move on to the next item of business after a short pause. Thank you.
Thank you, colleagues. The next item of business is consideration of motion 23466 on a financial resolution for the Scottish General Election Coronavirus Bill financial resolution. Can I call on Ben McPherson to move this motion?
Formally moved, Presiding Officer.
Thank you very much. The question on the matter will be put at decision time. The next item is consideration of business motion 23667 and 23668. 23667, in the name of Graeme Day, on behalf of the Parliamentary Business Parliamentary Bureau setting up a business programme, could I call on the Minister to move this motion?
Move, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. No member has indicated they wish to speak in the motion. The question, therefore, is that motion 23667 be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. The next item is consideration of business motion 23668. Again, could I call on Graeme Day to move this motion?
Move, Presiding Officer.
Thank you. No member has indicated they wish to speak on this motion. The question, therefore, is that motion 23668 be agreed. Are we all agreed? We are agreed. So we turn to decision time. The first question this evening is that motion 23648, in the name of Graeme Day, on the Scottish General Election Bill at Stage 1, be a Scottish General Election Coronavirus Bill at Stage 1, be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed. The next question is that motion 23646, in the name of Jean Freeman, on the Forensic Medical Services Victims of Sexual Offences Scotland Bill be agreed. Now, this is an act, so we're going to have to vote. Can I ask members, first of all, to refresh their voting screens? So they refresh your screens. And then we'll put the question. The question is that motion... Okay, well... Let's give a few seconds. If members refresh, and then we'll wait a second, and then when we put the vote, when I put the vote, I think that will actually change the screen. So we'll try that, okay? So the question is that motion 23646, in the name of Jean Freeman, on the Forensic Medical Services Victims of Sexual Offences Scotland Bill be agreed, and members may vote now. And hopefully in a minute, no, hopefully in a second, the vote will come up. Now, if colleagues have any difficulty at this stage, please raise your hand and attract the attention of IT or raise an inquiry online. That vote is now closed. Please let me know if you think you were not able to exercise your vote in the last minute. Thank you. The result of the vote on motion 23646 in the name of Jean Freeman is yes 122. There were no votes against, there were no abstentions. The motion is agreed and the Forensic Medical Services Victims of Sexual Offences Scotland Bill is passed. And our final question this evening is that motion 23466 in the name of Kate Forbes on the Scottish General Election Coronavirus Bill Financial Resolution be agreed. Are we all agreed?
Yes.
We are agreed, and that concludes decision time. I close this meeting.